I'm Vladimir Kramnik, Fortune's World Chess Champion. I would like to talk a bit today about prophylactics in chess, and because I've recorded a course on Chessable, which you can find quite recently, actually. So I'd like to tell what is it all about a little bit. Then I will show you another example on this thematic, and then probably I can answer some questions from you. I decided to make a course on prophylactics chess. You know, this element of chess is kind of a bit difficult to formalize. I would say it's positional play prophylactics. Prophylactics is a very general, very general term. So basically, I've been playing chess for quite some time, for quite many years, and thinking a lot about chess, actually trying to generalize certain things in chess, just because out of, if you want, curiosity. It's not necessarily useful sometimes for your practical chess, but there are some, so to say, eternal chess questions which are very interesting to think about, at least for me. So that would be, in this course I'm explaining a lot, about this whole concept, which I believe is the core of chess. I believe, because it's not so obvious, in fact, if you think deeply on about it, that basically during almost every game you play, prophylactic thinking, so trying to understand what is the plan of your opponent, what does he want in tactically and strategically. Well, you have to do it, I would say, several times at least during each game you play. So that's why this element of chess is maybe one of the most important, if not the most important, actually. At the same time, as it unfortunately usually happens, that such elements are also at the same time the most difficult to master, difficult to explain, and difficult to catch. At the same time, it gives you, most benefits, because improving in this particular element of chess is, because it's the most difficult, probably one of the most difficult, it gives you lots of profit, so to say. So it improves your game in general, your results and your understanding of chess, and also, again, because it's so difficult, many of your opponents wouldn't do it probably, because it's not easy. So I believe also why I decided to to record this course about this particular subject, because it's quite an ambitious project, because it's even difficult to explain it, not only to understand and to master, I said, because there are not so many books and not so much material on this subject, because usually trainers or chess writers, they somehow prefer to take more concrete subjects and which are in a way easier to explain, to put it in other words, easier to sell. but here it's also because it requires quite a high level of your chess understanding, quite a high level of a teacher, so to say, to explain it and to get this idea, and to that everybody, players of different levels can understand at least something out of it, and can that it can be useful for different levels, for people of different level, chess levels, and that they can all benefit and improve. Yeah. So what is it all about? Well, actually, as I've already said, I strongly believe that chess, in essence, is a game of prophylactics, in its essence. So of course there are many other elements of chess, but this one is the most important. Why? Because you know, you probably know already that in chess the players, they move one after another, yeah, strictly one after another. There is no way to play two moves in a row or to say pass, yeah, not to make a move. So basically that means that every move you play or your opponent play is a result of the last move of the opponent, yeah. So basically it's a counteraction. Actually, every move, it is a counteraction. So that makes it you know, and actually when you are making your move, unless you are totally winning and your opponent has zero play and queen and rook down, basically he wants to do something next. So you always trying to consider, and better you become, you are more considering more and more and finding more and more ideas for your opponent. And actually, that is the main way, I mean, the main kind of way to improve in chess, because I've noticed myself, and yeah, I mean, it's for everyone, it's the same story, that you become a stronger player. I mean, you feel like you improved most of the time, that it comes with the fact that you see more and more ideas for your opponent. In fact, so you start to see. So at the beginning, you just miss some mate in two, which your opponent is threatening, and realizing then you blunder a piece on the next level. Then you miss some attack. Then slowly, okay. Then you already cover this, but you're missing some maneuver, which he's, you know, which he has in mind, and so like this somehow. Yeah, at some point you miss very little of your opponent, and then if you are not Magnus Carlsen, you still lose to Magnus Carlsen for some reason. But basically, I mean, that is the main source of improvement, is actually to see more and more for your opponent, to be more and more careful. Because I believe, again, it's if you want, it's something, I don't know, physiological even, yeah, because you know that it's always easier, and I'm sure each of you will agree that it's always much easier to see some tactics for yourself than for your opponent, because we have such a biological structure. Yeah, we see more for ourselves. It's because we are inside our own body, and somehow it's easier. Yeah, I mean, that is so actually seeing more for your opponent, it's yeah, it improves your play. I mean, gets you to the next level, you know, much faster, yeah, because there is a, I mean, well, the top players, the main difference, stronger player is more nuances, more deeper he sees for his opponent, more tactics and so on, yeah, as I explained already. And yeah, I've developed a certain rather simple, I would say, at least seemingly simple procedure, if you want, you know, when you are having a certain position, and well, the position is not very tactical, you know, there is nothing very clear, so you're a bit at a loss, many options, so it's a certain process of thinking which can help you, you know, to get to the right decision, at least to understand better the main characteristics of the positions, and in particular the main threats, yeah, whether tactical or during this course, you know, I'm more talking about positional threats, or you know, some kind of counterplay of your opponent. So there are certain, you know, when you think, of course, thinking process in chess is something rather complicated, yeah, that it's difficult to formalize it. But in any case, there must be a certain discipline. I do not believe in very strict discipline. I mean that, you know, like because, you know, chess is not just mathematics. It's not like you're solving a mathematical task and there is a very clear order of of your thoughts. I don't know. They have to be organized in one clear way, and it's always bringing you to the right conclusion. Chess is fortunately more complicated than that, and it's also a game. It's a game of creativity. So sometimes a little bit of a chaos in your mind can be also helpful in some situations. But in any case, there must be a certain structure and certain questions. I mean, certain ways how to get to the right decision and how to understand, you know, in general, the position, the strategical aspects. I'm trying to explain quite a lot. I mean, just actually, I've collected quite many examples there. Most of them are from my games and on this particular thematic. And then I'm trying to go quite deep into it and just try and step by step to explain because of course other top chess players, they have their own way of you know, thinking and coming to their own decisions, but I'm trying to explain what do I think about this position, why. So I start with this, then I didn't like this because of that, then I start to see that maybe this piece is not standing too well. So and then finally, so the whole path, how do I think during a game? So I think it's quite useful. If you go, if you study this course, it's a little bit different than studying openings or something. You know, it's something which I call a non-direct learning, which I believe is the most important part of our learning. Yeah, because the direct learning is like memorizing something. You memorize, let's say, if you're in history, the date of a certain historical event, or in chess, you just memorize certain opening, move per move. But there is a non-direct learning, which is just trying to understand the thinking process of a top player, the pattern, you know, just like listening, maybe sometimes not fully understanding everything, but all of a sudden, as my experience shows, quite often it leads to a significant improvement in your play all of a sudden, even if you feel like you didn't get much. I mean, it happened to me very often in my chess career that actually, and I also tell a couple of stories about it in this course, that actually I would improve certain elements of chess. I mean, I improve as a chess player by listening, trying to see some top players, how do they think, and sometimes I would find it strange, or I feel like I didn't get it really. Only, to my surprise, realizing after some time that I started to play better in this type of position. So something got there in the subconsciousness or whatever you call it. Yeah. So you start to play better. And this is not something abstract or, you know, it's actually the main, I believe it is the way we learn. We don't know. Yeah. We don't know how exactly our brain functions and how do we learn things. But I feel, I feel that this is the most important part of learning in chess is just that, you know, if you get a good quality information somewhere into your brain, you of course make an effort, and then some kind of work is going on there somewhere in deep corners of your mind, yeah, and all of a sudden you feel like, you know, then you play better, you understood this thing. How, you don't know. Anyways, it's just my way of seeing it, but I felt like that was mainly the way I was improving in chess, learning chess. It's just, without being conscious of the result, but I could see clearly by statistics, if you want, that it was there. So, anyways, coming back to prophylactics, well, actually, it's of course mainly in most important, this element comes when it gets to positional play and certain subtle strategical positions, but you know, very often, even in extremely sharp tactical situations, it's still there. You know, it's like an element which is all the time with you during a game of chess. And I'm giving you lots of examples there as I, during the course that I've explained already. But, you know, basically almost every day, if there is a, some, you know, well, good chess tournament going on, you can easily catch and find a very, very interesting and nice example on the same thematic, which I'm going to do now. So I thought, just getting ready for this lecture, I said, okay, I should probably find a very recent example which would explain you. I mean, a new one which is not in the course. So, and I just went to the World, I mean, to some, I checked a few games of the World Cup, which is going on now in Sochi. And I just found, you know, very quickly one game which totally suits this, and I'm trying, I will try to present you, which is also will be a kind of interesting test for you. And at the same time, it will be probably a good example, and that you understand what is it all about, this whole element, yeah, this whole subject I'm talking about now, and I'm trying to explain this as well as I can during those, I don't know, 11 hours course, yeah. So this is a position I would like all of you to think about it. It's black to move. Well, white is piece up, as you can see, but black is slightly more active, let's put it mildly. And very, very complicated situation, extremely sharp. Yeah, I mean, of course, black is, white seems to be pretty much tied up, but it's still a piece. The king, white king is not safe, and so on and so on. So what I, why I'm telling you all this, because also I explain it in this course, that that's always what I try to do before starting to go into concrete details. It's just a general picture, as I call it, a scanning of the position, just to scan it and to find as many relevant elements. It's also important because, you know, sometimes you can say that, I don't know, this potentially black king is, can get mated on the 8th rank. Okay, it's also an element, but it's not really relevant in this particular position. So you need, of course, to distinguish, you know, something which is, you know, which can be a serious factor on the position, and something which probably wouldn't be. So that's why I'm telling you all this, because I'm like, it's my first idea about this position. Yeah, I look at it, and you know, it's, you know, what would I say? Okay, piece up, white is tied up, king is weak. Yeah, but then I don't see any concrete direct way for black to take the piece back. So yeah, more or less this. Yeah, and then I start to go to the concrete, to the details. So try to think about it and take your time. Maybe if you want, take few minutes. I mean, it is a complicated position. It's very complicated. So even 20 minutes wouldn't be enough, because actually it's a game Swidler, I think Swidler Vitugov from the World Cup, second or third round. Actually, Vitugov, he didn't find the best move. So try to understand what is white's idea, what is black to move. Yeah, I mentioned already. So what is white's idea, and what should black do in this position? Yeah, you can write me down, I mean, some thoughts, but don't hurry, yeah? Try to go a bit deeper. I mean, yeah, take a bit of time. Especially when it gets to concrete variations. So what I wanted to also, why I showing you this example, just to show you that even in such positions, yeah, when it's like seemingly extremely tactical and forcing, you still have to think what is the plan of your opponent. What do you want to do? I mean, what is his next? Yeah, what does he want? Because unless you have a forcing, but yeah, I don't see it. And yeah, so there is no force way for black to win a material or whatever. Yeah, then it's about actually, you know, then the right question is, what is the next move of your opponent? What is the plan of your opponent here? How is he planning to unpin to? And once you ask this right question, then it's a first step. It's only the very first step to the right answer, but it's a step which is without this step probably you will not get to the right answer. So it is important. You know, there was some Greek guy long time ago. I think it was Plato. Yeah, was his name, who said the right question is half of the right answer. Yeah. So if you want the right answer, setting up the right question is very helpful. So the right question is, what is white's next? So I see that people are writing different things. So yeah, some people. So let me explain. Okay, I think that, you know, when you have this question, what helps, and I also explained this in that course, that if you want really to understand what is the idea of your opponent, you know, what your opponent wants to do, very often sometimes in your mind, or even on the board, you can do this. One second. You can just flip the board and imagine it's white to play here. So what would be his move? What would be your move if you're white here? I think then it becomes quite clear, bishop d2, yeah? I mean, you want to develop pieces, bishop d2, rook e1. I see that you write also, some of you write b3 move, but after b3, you still don't want to unpin. I mean, you cannot unpin really, but bishop d2, rook e1 is improving your position significantly. Well, you want to get the rook into the game, yeah, from a1. So that is all. Okay, so now we see that probably white's main idea is bishop d2. Of course, he has maybe other ideas like queen f2. Maybe I'm not quite sure also that you are threatening anything after queen f2 because your knight still cannot move. There is rook d1 check, but the mainly bishop d2. So like this, that is the first step to the right direction. So bishop. So we have to try probably to do something about bishop d2. So to make some useful move, which is improving our position and developing initiative, but having in mind that bishop d2 is white's next. Yeah. So then it's another question, but it's not the whole solution. Yeah, chess would be a simple game if it would be so easy. Then the question is, how exactly and what are the pluses and minuses of each move which would prevent bishop d2? For example, I see that many of you some of you at least are offering rook e4, which is true. It's very logical, natural move. And that is, if you don't ask this question, That is a big temptation to play this move, but I'm afraid bishop d2 comes, yeah? And I don't know if rook e8, maybe rook e1. I mean, white is getting, you know, getting his pieces together somehow and steal his piece up, yeah? So otherwise, it's true that it would be a very good move, rook e4. That is why, you know, I show you also this example. It's very important because, I mean, normally rook e4 is like a move which you play quickly, yeah? If you don't ask the question, you just play rook e4 and you get bishop d2, yeah? So if you ask the question, then you see that bishop d2 is probably something to take care of. Then the next question is how exactly. Actually, Vitugov, I think he didn't manage it correctly. I mean, he grasped it clearly because of the move he played, but he didn't manage to find the correct way. Because he played queen d4 here. Queen d4. Yeah, I see queen e5. I recommend queen e5, but it's has the same, I think queen d4 is a bit more active, but it has, this, I think, more or less the same minus. Queen d4 and queen e5. So the best move here was queen c6, as I also see that a few of the students, they propose this move. This is the best, actually a difficult move, yeah, to find, a very difficult move. You very unlikely to find this move unless you have all this, you know, procedure, thinking procedure, asking question, because queen is active on c5, pinning kind of putting pressure on the knight on e3, so why to play queen c6? Well, the answer is simple, because bishop d2, rook takes d2, yeah? So you're stopping this, yeah, and queen d2, queen f3, yeah? So you cannot play bishop d2 anymore. And anyway, queen is, I mean, quite active on this diagonal also, but in a way, you know, you see it's an extremely sharp and, you know, messy position, but queen c6 is a purely prophylactic move, in a way, in its essence. It's a prophylactics, yeah, queen c6. And after queen c6, actually the position black would be doing very well. I mean, again, I checked a bit with the computer this position. He says that white can still be fine here. But I would say that finding this move could actually turn the game completely, because now I would say from a practical point of view, okay, for computer, I can tell you it assesses this position as 0-0, as most of the positions, and for him, whatever, he would find a way to make a draw. But, you know, for humans, after queen c6, it's becoming not easy for white, yeah, with white to play, because somehow some kind of annoying, now probably you want some rook d4 just to continue. Maybe I'm thinking, actually, myself, maybe sometimes even rook d3 can be an idea, yeah? So at least his best line is computers to play in h4. Not really an easy move to make. I mean, you as white, bishop takes h4, rook h3, bishop g5, and bishop d2. So you see, he gave a pawn, I mean, but at least now he can play bishop d2. And here, like with three or four moves, black is fine. It's equal, I mean, so finally, it's probably with the best play of, you know, of each side, it's a draw. Even h6, as computer likes, finds h5, a very interesting move. Even h6, black is just okay, because on the way, if white is still tied up and bishop is thrown on g5, so anyways, it's already another story, yeah, the game would continue. But in my opinion, after queen c6, in a practical sense, even the position is equal. If I would be black, definitely, I would take black. I would like to play with black. It has more potential. But Vitugov, he played queen d4. Also, by the way, a move which was offered by some of you. Yeah, makes a lot of sense, it's true. But here we get to this, you know, complexity of this subject of understanding what your opponent wants and prophylactics and so on. So now I would maybe stop and ask you what would you play with white here? I mean, why queen d4 is less precise than queen c6? Yes, unfortunately, I don't know how exactly to write to answer your messages, but so I can just tell to copy bar that he is completely right again. That is why Queen c6, which actually he also, or she, I don't know, proposed, was better than Queen d4. Okay, so knight c2 is offered, but it's a tactical motive, but actually black can take back piece, yeah, after queen d1 check. That's why this chess is such a nasty game, yeah, because it's not only you have to ask questions to understand what your opponent wants strategically, tactically, and also to calculate variations. It's quite a bad luck, yeah, that we all play chess, because it's too complicated. The problem is knight c2, otherwise would have been probably a good move, but here the problem that I can take back the piece and black is, well, a bit better. I don't know how much better, but it's black who is on top here. So it's not actually knight c2. Second. So what else then? A very, very sophisticated, I would say, idea. And Swidler, he caught it, so he played a4. A very strong idea. So you see, he saw that bishop d2 is one of the defensive plan, but he means that a4 rook a3 actually is another very, very good way to get coordination of white's pieces. And you see, the thing is that with a queen on c6, you cannot play rook a3 because the bishop is hanging on c1. That is, and with a queen on d4, now rook a3 is becoming a real threat. And then rook enters into a game. And also, it's actually having extremely good square c3, and also it protects the knight. So it's another bishop on c1 is sort of developed already. So if white gets rook a3, rook c3, he's fully in control. Yeah. So that is what he missed. So he understood one, but you see how subtle is this. Yeah. So bishop d2, because with a queen on c5, a4 is not really threatening anything. Yeah. But once something changes, he immediately has a problem with a4. So a4, still now, he played queen e4. Actually, rook c8 was possible, computer says. But I just show you this as a more an example of like a training for you, because it's extremely, as a professional chess player, I can tell you, it's extremely complicated position. It's very difficult to play over the board. But let's say rook c8, very difficult move to make. The computer says that it's kind of playable. So he takes this pawn, this is his main line, queen e5, don't ask me why. And I don't know, he gives here, I don't know, 0-5 for white. So kind of, it's not too bad for black. But it doesn't look good, yeah, because it's not about pawns. Yeah, not this position, not about pawns, taking the pawn. I mean, the problem is that now white has coordinated his pieces. So I wouldn't play like this with black. I mean, visually, humanly, we are not computers. Yeah, humanly, I don't like it at all, but computer says that it was playable. Anyways, actually, he played queen e4. Actually, it is the best move in the position. After e4, queen e4 was played. Yeah, instead of rook c8, queen e4. So you see, now there is no bishop d2. But on the way, instead of queen c6, queen e4, yeah, he gave this a4 idea. Anyway, situation is not too bad yet. So rook a3, of course, white is using a chance to get his rook into the game. And now another extremely difficult move. I mean, really very, very, yeah, I mean, well, very difficult to understand why and what, but it's still something about prophylactic. So try to find, try to think what would be the best move here for black. I mean, I'm not sure I would have found it or anyone else. It's very, very difficult, very subtle idea, but I think quite educational to see how much actually prophylactics is in chess, how much, you know, you have to see for your opponent and to prevent it in time. So again, the same question. Yeah, first, is there is any way for black to take material or some tactics? I don't see. White is already, white's position has improved significantly, yeah, since he got this a4, rook a3. So somehow he got coordination. So, but again, now the question is still the same. What is, what is white's next move? So what does he want to do next? Yeah, you're right. Yeah, I see rook c3. Yeah, his next is rook c3. And then after rook c3, let's say rook c3. Okay, not the end of the day yet, yeah? But after rook c3, what would be what would be his next after rook c3? So probably, I would say, he wants rook c3, rook c4, probably. Yeah, something like that, for instance. I mean, rook c3, because I guess he wants, let's say, if black just plays some move, just some absolutely senseless move, just to show his evaluation. I mean, rook c3, now probably white wants next something like rook c4, yeah, I guess. That's quite logical. For instance, if bishop f6, then rook c4, yeah. And then it's still a long way, but I guess like bishop d4, I guess it's already getting close, like king g2. Now rook is very good on c4, yeah, pinning, then maybe queen c2. So it's a piece, yeah. At the end of the day, it looks like it's a piece. So, Vityugov, he played rook c8. Actually, what he played, he just decided to play rook c8, rook c3. He took on c3 and took on a4. Okay, that is already, I guess, is not played, it's played with a heavy heart. I mean, it's clear that it's already just trying to, let's say, to try to make a draw, maybe to collect a second pawn, and who knows, because of limited material, changing queen, maybe he can make a draw, but it's clear that black is already worse after that, yeah? But in it, maybe it looks like already here black is worse, but actually computer, he finds some very, very nice resource. But in fact, when you think about it, it's again, it's very logical. So rook c3, what is important? C4 square, yeah, for the rook. So computer plays b5, a b, yeah? Which is, again, it's pure prophylactics. It just takes control on the c4 square. I mean, I really found this example very instructive and very beautiful in a way, because it's like the position, you are pissed down and you are making prophylactic moves with black all the time. And actually after b5, he says that black is in time in every line to equalize here. He doesn't see any advantage for white. Because rook c3, still trying to coordinate pieces, but now bishop f6, you see, he just protected the c4 square. I mean, the main goal of this b5 move is to protect. And now rook c2, and now rook d3 is just in time to stop, because rook d3, again, as you see, it's prophylactics, yeah, because probably white wants at some point to jump with a knight somewhere, but rook d3 also, I mean, not only prophylactic, it's an active move, of course, but also it is a way, you know. And then finally rook d2 is the best move for white. Again, I tell you, of course, it's easy for me to speak because I checked it with a computer. During a game, I wouldn't envy both players. It's very, very difficult position to play. Such a strange situation when this piece, you don't know, who is better, you know, maybe white king can get mated. Otherwise, if he just managed to coordinate pieces, he's winning. So very difficult position to play. So rook d2, rook b3. So you see, he somehow gets always in time. Black is always in time to keep white pinned, you know, totally pinned. And now, let's say, I mean, his best variation, I just show you, there are many different options, but all in all, he says it's a draw. So I think he's playing rook d1 now for some reason. Don't ask me why. I guess he just wants to protect the nine. Maybe he slowly wants to regroup like king g2. And now, okay, he says that after bishop takes b2, takes on b2, takes, takes on b2, queen takes f3, queen f2. Of course, it's computer, yeah? He sees everything. That there is an eighth rank mate, so everything under control. The knight is not hanging. But still, after queen f4, actually, he just says that it's a draw. I mean, because the king is too weak, yeah? And this b-pawn can start to run, so probably it will end in a draw, at least according to the computer. It doesn't matter, again, because those lines are very difficult to, you know, to calculate for a human being, but this b5 move is that is findable, very difficult but findable, yeah, when you understand the idea. Rook c3, rook c4 is so he played instead rook c8. It's still not all. Rook c3, so he took queen takes a4, king g2 was played. So still, white has quite some problems here, yeah, with these pieces. Okay, it's one positive point is that one of those pieces is an extra piece, is a knight, so which makes life a bit easier. But still, queen f4 still not easy to regroup, yeah, somehow. Queen f2. So now again, think again in this position. So what to do? What would you do with black here? And again, the same thing. Ask the right questions. Which is most of the time in chess. What is your opponent's plan or next move, or what does he want to do next? In fact, yeah, there's not so much white can do, yeah, in this position. He's still pretty much tied up here. But, so that's why Vityugov played a5, which was a decisive mistake, actually. White is already better. It's clear that it's white who is playing for a win already, for sure. I mean, black is on the defensive, no doubt. He's just trying to escape. And I mean, again, maybe if you are a computer, probably this position is already objectively lost for black. I mean, but one thing is computer-wise lost, you know, that it's like you have to make 10 best moves with white to win it, or it's deadly lost even for a human, yeah? So he played a5. Again, yeah, you see, a bit missing this prophylactic thinking. Okay, we have to admit, I guess he had quite little time left already. Yeah, so a5, trying to push the pawn, the most logical move you can make. But the problem is that h4 now comes. Because bishop e3 is no big deal. I mean, I take and I don't care about this g4 pawn. Now I have all pieces under control, yeah? I mean, my bishop gets to d4 and then I regroup and that's it. Yeah, it's a piece up. So the point is that bishop f6, after h4, bishop f6. And... okay, here g5 is strong, also queen c2 is strong, and g5 both. In fact, a very important point that white has this g5 idea in this position. G5, bishop takes e3, I think computer even plays f6 and actually starts an attack here. It's pretty bad for black. So then, yeah, again, very strange for such a position. What was very important is to get this prophylactic thinking that since you cannot really stop h4, at least you should stop g5. And by far the best move is h6 in this position. Of course, it's also useful to get the 8th rank, you know, to get some space for the king, but actually mainly h4, bishop f6, mainly the idea that you stop g5 in this position. And in fact, it's still very difficult for white to win this position. I mean, you have to be extremely precise with white. For instance, I give you the main line of the computer here, and you can understand that actually everything is still possible, all three results. So computer's main line, queen c2, queen c6. So you see, if not, you know, if h6 wouldn't have been played, then g5 at any moment comes and white, you know, it improves white's position significantly. But here there is no g5, so white has still to do, you know, not so easy still to unpin, you know, to get your pieces together. So queen d3, very logical, trying to go knight d5, rook e4. So now, I mean, I guess knight d5, rook takes g4 is possible. So rook e4, and okay, white has to find, in order to be better, maybe even close to winning, but has to find some very difficult moves. King h3, not an easy move. Rook d4, queen f1, because the rook is hanging on. So queen f1. Rook d3 actually looks very scary for white, yeah, because rook now enters. So it's computer, again, has very little to do with human chess, because especially it's move 32 or something, I'm probably very short on time, both players, very difficult to play the position to find the best moves here. So, but I just, for the sake of being objective, so the best move is c4, trying to go knight d5. Queen e4, stopping knight d5. Rook g3, now very difficult. Rook g3. Bishop e5, queen f3. I mean, this is almost impossible. I can assure you, even for top player, very difficult to find over the board. This queen d4, rook g1, I think, or rook g2. He's playing, and finally he says that it's rook g1. Finally, white is much better, but still not, I wouldn't say that it's totally winning or something. Yeah, I mean, it's just, well, good winning chances, no more than that. But you see how difficult is play here, yeah? Also for white. So it's still very open game here. Yeah, there was a question, why not, sorry, why not to take on c3? Where exactly? I don't see where I can take on c3, actually. I mean, if I take on c3, changing queens, that's not good for me, yeah? But I don't really see a time when I can take on this, because knight d5 is threatening. So here, queen takes c3, knight d5, I guess, is coming, yeah? If you take here some tactics, probably. So rook d3, c4, now you cannot take already. So anyway, those are complicated variations. So I show you quickly what happened in the game. So what was played, a5, h4, and yeah, now things are, well, already not too difficult for a player like Peter Swidler, of course. So actually, queen c6 had to be played. I mean, was played. Bishop f6, sorry. Yeah, he g5 is strong, as I showed, but also queen c2, the move which was played by Swidler, is also very strong here. Queen c6, and you see the difference, yeah? If you had pawn on h6, it wouldn't be too bad, yeah? But here g5 comes. And this is a decisive, decisive move in the position. Because after bishop e5, you don't have rook e4 anymore. So he gets c4, knight d5. So Vitugov took on c3 and knight d1. And that's it. So he had to play bishop e5, queen c6, bc6. And of course, it's just a technically simple win, yeah, because only two pawns and endgame, white has full coordination. So Peter, he won the game. Very quickly here. So, okay, this example, I mean, it's pretty much will be the whole course is going to be that boring, that difficult. I mean, that's complex. Yeah, it's not easy. I mean, but it's okay. I mean, what is important is to get this feeling, the understanding of the importance of this element of chess, that even in such complicated position, the chess is pretty much roughly about understanding what is the plan or next move of your opponent. Yeah. Yeah, and it's not only in very, you know, safe, solid position. Even in such positions, you see everybody is always, you know, so the one who manages better, he, you know, he wins. So Black actually had three times, only in these few moves, they had three times, actually, this very important task. Yeah, Quincy's, I mean, to understand Bishop D2 is the idea, then to see that there is a4 is another idea, once queen is not there, yeah, then to play b5 to protect, you remember that here, yeah, also very kind of prophylactic idea, sorry, queen d4, yeah, queen d4, a4, then here this b5 move, very difficult prophylactic move to cover the c4 square, and after h6 move, yeah, also prophylactic move. So, yeah, that is one, but of course there will be many, many more examples in this course, and most of them are more positional. Here I just show you a more tactical one, but all in all, so you see the, yeah, the level of the player, yeah, it's about this. So it's very difficult element. You see even players, very top grandmaster, very strong grandmasters like Pityugov, cannot, you know, manage, yeah, very often. Don't worry, you know, you will never be perfect in it, because nobody is, not me, not Carlson. It's very difficult, yeah. But what I want that you catch the sense of it, yeah, that when you play chess in your next game, that you start to get this idea in your mind, you start to have this question, you start to wonder and to find the right answers, you know, to pose the right questions, to find the right answers. So, so all this course is pretty much explaining how, why, what. I mean, of course, every position is different. Yeah, so you cannot, fortunately, I think, rather than unfortunately, because then everybody would play on the same level chess, yeah, that you cannot find, you know, a kind of formula, mathematical formula, how to find the best move or how to find always to correctly understand what your opponent wants, yeah. But that I think that listening for hours and hours explaining, you know, of this, you get something in any case, some more, some less, you know, some has more talent to, you know, to positional chess, to prophylactic, somebody a bit less, but anyway, it's useful for all levels, you know, of players. And so that's why I, yeah, if you want, if you have time, if you're interested in chess, to improve in chess, because this is something not so much enjoyable. In a way, in my opinion, yes, also, because I like this, you know, for me, chess, I enjoy the logics of chess, the kind of this, I very much appreciate and enjoy the games which are, you know, when one of the opponents or sometimes both, they went very deep, you know, and they understood very deeply, you know, so they're very subtle, making lots of subtle moves, fighting with each other plans. Yeah, it's not to everyone liking because, well, of course, some combinations, attacks are maybe more beautiful at the first sight, but first of all, I find its own beauty in this as well, and secondly, yeah, that it's just very important element of chess, yeah, to improve, that it's really something essential, yeah, in chess. So yeah, that was what I wanted to tell you for today, and maybe I can, if you want, I can answer a few questions. If you have questions, please ask me, don't hesitate. Yeah, so I see the question, what rating range would you recommend for this course? Well, as I explained, of course it is actually, it's pretty high level. I mean, if you want to get all of it, yeah, I mean, the understand everything. Yeah, it's actually 2500 plus. But at the same time, I think from the level 1.8 or something, it can already be useful because, yeah, because of what I've mentioned already today, that even if you don't get everything there, but something will stay. Yeah, all those questions, those thinking patterns, yeah, in such positions will help you to find the best moves, you know, to understand the, you know, the nuances of the position, the threats of the of your opponents. So I would say that, yeah, from that rating should be already enough to yeah, that it can really improve your chess level. Which book teaches prophylactics best? That's a point. That's why I decided to record it, because I don't know too many books, actually. I don't know too many good books at all, or even books in general, which are teaching this particular subject. Yeah. So, frankly, of course, I read lots of chess books, but it just doesn't come to my mind any book which particularly deals with this thematic. So I cannot really recommend you. But what I can clearly recommend you, and again, I have a full chapter, a full lesson about it, is to study games of Anatoly Karpov. He was a fantastic prophylactic player. I'm explaining the why in details. So his games, I think he had such an incredible subtle feeling for prophylactics that, yeah, he's probably the best ever prophylactic player. So I would recommend his games. Recognizing your opponent resources, developing, preventing, thinking by Dvoretsky is a book. I've heard about this book. I've never read it. No, I mean, Dvoretsky is a fantastic author. That's true. His books are usually extremely good. But just a friend of mine at some point long ago, I think, he sent me some example from this book. And well, with some explanation of Dvoretsky, I mean, it was a game of Karpov, and in fact, I just totally disagree with him. I mean, he gives exclamation mark to some prophylactic move of Anatoly, who was actually still far from being world champion. He was very young still, which I found actually is a mistake. I don't think it's a right move. I mean, it's just a name, Karpov, and you know, that it felt like it's you know, it must be a good move because it's prophylactic, but in reality, I think it was not. And also, don't forget, at that time when Dvoretsky was writing his books, the computers were not strong, not too strong, and not maybe not even existing at all. I don't really know exactly when was this book written. So my examples, I went through all those examples with a powerful machine. So the, you know, so then I tried to have a kind of computer proof that this particular prophylactic move is really good. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, maybe I guess this book is also good of Dvoretsky. I don't know. How to use your method when you low on time? It's just making it more difficult. But again, you know, the thing is that this method, this prophylactic thinking, it takes some time, that it becomes a routine. It becomes a reflex at some point. So, of course, with less time, you do it worse because you don't have enough time. But what I want to achieve with all those examples and so on, that you will, you know, it will be the first question which comes to your mind in almost any position when your opponent played the move and it's your turn. So what is his next? What does he want? I mean, that is also, it's like a discipline. I mean, once it becomes a reflectory, because for many, it's not actually, yeah, for many players. I'm not talking, of course, about top players, but in general, it's not like the first intention. Because I can assure you, a professional player, a top professional player, this is immediately. Your opponent plays a move, the first thing you ask yourself, okay, what does he want? What is his neck? What is his plan? It's just automatic. And once it becomes automatic, that's already a very big achievement. Then it's a still long way until you master it better and better, until you master it to a very high level. But it has to be a reflex. So talking about time control, yeah, it's more difficult. But if it's not reflectory, you know, if it's not your way of thinking in chess, then it becomes almost impossible with limited time to find, at least we are talking about subtle prophylactic moves. But if it's reflectory, it's already, the chances are higher. Do you need good calculation skills to think prophylactically? Well, I mean, it's connected, but calculation is connected with any, whatever you do. You attack, well, you need to calculate variations, yeah? You defend, you also need to calculate. Endgame, yeah, but you must calculate an endgame as well. So calculation is something which is like, you know, it goes with everything. It's like a salad, yeah? It can go with any main course, yeah? So, yeah, calculation is a part of your chess skills. It has to be. In any case, whatever your style and so on. But of course, yeah, also in prophylactics, it is important, yeah, because calculation, but maybe less than in other elements of chess, such as, you know, combination, endgames also. Actually, endgames is a lot of calculation in endgames as well. So this kind of goes without saying that you need also to calculate variations. Don't misunderstand me that you will not manage to find the best prophylactic moves without any calculation. No, unfortunately, you need still to calculate variations, my friends. It's very difficult without good calculation. Would you suggest any opening to perfect this skill? You know, it is such a, you mean if you're talking about prophylactics, it is such a, you know, daily matter that almost any opening you play, any type of game, I mean, it appears on the board. It's just a different pawn structure, different type of position, but basically I don't think it depends so much on the opening you play. You will have, I can assure you, you'll have enough of opportunities to show your, you know, skills in prophylactics, prophylactic thinking, independently on the openings you play, unless it is maybe totally direct sync where both players are trying to mate each other, you know, just in a direct tactical clash, but that happens not too often. Are there any modern players who, in your opinion, show a strong understanding of prophylactics? Well, of course, Magnus, obviously. Yeah, I mean, he's strong in this, but also he's a very deep player. Yeah, but, you know, again, this is a skill. Better you play, better is the skill, another way around. Yes, so basically any strong player, stronger he is, you can be sure that it's not necessarily that 2700 player is better than 2600 player in endgame sometimes, or sometimes in tactics, not always. I mean, sometimes not, but for sure in prophylactics, in understanding, I mean, preventing the ideas or plans of your opponent, for sure. So, I mean, it just comes together simply. Is it possible at the same time play active and prophylactically? Yes, it is possible, and I show quite a number of examples in my course, which is the case. Yeah, I mean, by the way, this example, in a way, it is also the case. Yeah, like B5, yeah, move. You remember here, it was active but also prophylactic in a way, so it's both. But yeah, that's absolutely correct. You can. So what are the other questions? Okay, I will pick up the one more question. What time control do you recommend playing online to improve in chess? And is Blitz good? It's okay, Blitz. I mean, I think that Blitz, well, 1 minute, I think there is, well, it can only damage. I mean, it's fun, yeah, it's fun. People say, I mean, I never really understood why it's funny. I mean, for me, I never enjoyed it. But okay, I guess people, if they like to play, so I guess they But otherwise, it's chess at least at minimum. 3 plus 2 is already okay. I think 3 plus 2 is already fine. I think, well, 5 more, you want to improve, you need time. Yeah, you need time to think. So more time to think you have, better it is, you know. So the other point, I understand that, well, people have different circumstances. Some, they just have little time, yeah. And they don't have enough. Yeah, they don't have half an hour, 1 hour. So then play 3 plus 2. But in general, I prefer 5 plus 2, 5 plus 3. Because one, it is interesting, and at the same time, it is educational, I believe. So, okay, last question. I will. Yeah, is it enough to play prophylactic but have no plans? I cover it in the course as well. So, what is your favorite chapter in the course? It depends. I mean, it's a course for you, not for me. So, it's a question. I mean, yeah. I hope you will have at least one which you will like, one of the chapters, but that's all yours. And the last question, yeah, I see it because I've seen it twice already. What did you plan to play against first d4 in the match with Kasparov? Okay, actually he played d4 against me in the 15th game, in the last game of the match, so you could see that I was planning to play all this classical thing, Nimzo-Indian, Queen's Gambit, Catalan. So that was the plan, which I only had a chance once to play, and it was Catalan, finally. Okay, good, gentlemen. So hope it was not too boring. And again, if you want to study this, to try my course, you're welcome. If not, it's everybody is free. But it will be not easy. I can warn you immediately. It's not a funny course. It is really something. Which requires some effort for you, from you, but that can really, if you do it well and if you really make this effort and take your time, it can, I believe it can improve really your chess, whatever it is, your level is now. So all the very best to you and enjoy the game of chess.